Do you ever hear Bob Crane's show?
Yes, yes, I did. Mm-hmm.
Who is he anyway?
Bob Crane?
Yeah. Who are his family? What's his background?
Well, he's a kid that was born in the slums. And
yes.
He never had a chance. He came to Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And my sister-in-law knows him. She says he's like he is on the A's, a sweet guy.
Yeah.
And you think desperately of something to say to him because all he has is his background to
knows,
talk about.
Yes,
his poverty, So what can you do with a guy?
That's
but he,
so
he
wonderful.
Tries.
When these poor kids make a place for themselves.
Exactly,
right.
Exactly. Because you take your average kid who has had
everything.
He's not going to try to be a disc jockey.
No.
He's not going to make that long climb.
No.
Why
should
he?
These people are driven by, their own,
urge.
Insecurity.
Yeah.
And,
it comes out of ambition, but it's insecurity as far as I'm concerned.
Can I have another cup of coffee?
Yeah.
After that opening, I'm not sure I should tell you. This is Bob Crane again.
Oh, hello there.
Hello there, Charlie. This is our special 5th anniversary program for the next 45 minutes. We've got a couple of features we think you'll like. For instance, we're going to have Jonathan Witters, who was our in-person guest during this past year, with us. We're going to have Nichols and May again, and so many other people. And we do hope you'll stay with us, because this show is just for you, dear.
Oh, for me? Oh, nice.
Oh, yeah. Oh, dear. This is our 5th anniversary show, and a very happy good Saturday afternoon to you. This is Bob Crane. And it's rather strange for us, of course, to be on a Saturday afternoon. We're usually here in the morning from 6:05 to 5:10 during the week, and on Saturday we're on from 8 until 12 noon, and the usual type things. But today, being 5 years here in town, we decided to have a special show set aside from our regular type things to repeat some of what we consider the best of our endeavors over the past 5 years since coming here to town from back east. And of course, when this was first announced, we were going to have the best of Crane for 5 years. Quite a few people said, what's going to end up as a station break? And, cute things like that. My own engineer had that to say when I said, Jack, we're going to do the best of the year, the best of 5 years, in fact.
That is a peachy, splendid, paramount, cardinal idea.
If you are just waking up and you suddenly find yourself coming down with a headache, 9 out of 10 doctors themselves have found that there is nothing like aspirin to get rid of the pain. That's a pretty sweeping statement to make, but we can make it because it's our show and there ain't nobody going to tell us what we can say. Now, the makers of Bayer Aspirin do make a delicious aspirin. There's no such thing as a delicious aspirin. I'm so used to saying everything's delicious, you fall into these things. The makers of Bayer Aspirin do make a good aspirin. Over 4,000 doctors were asked if they themselves took aspirin, and 90% of these doctors said yes, and that's not surprising. After all, doctors have recommended aspirin for years. In newspapers, magazines, personal consultation, aspirin is the one thing doctors consistently recommend. Of course, in the newspaper ads, it's usually an actor that's doing the recommending, but what do you know? This consistent that's not a very nice thing to say to a listener, is it?
No,
what do you know?
I
could tell you what the secret ingredients are in the
aspirin. Don't. No, I don't want to know.
You don't want to know?
No.
You want to be just a...
I just want to go on using it.
A Bayer aspirin.
That's right.
There is a technical name for
it. I don't want to know. Thank you.
All right. I
don't want to know. Thank you very much.
All right. Aspirin is what doctors themselves take, so
what is it?
Chicken fat and bulls. And for the youngsters, get flavored Bayer aspirin for the children. Bayer aspirin, the best aspirin the world has ever known. And you know what we want to do now.
Oh, I know what you
mean. You know what I want to do now. We're going to repeat one of our interviews that we've done over the past 5 years, when we've interviewed something like over 300 different personalities, from Marilyn Monroe to Rock Hudson to the fellow that shines our shoes here in the building.
Robert Crane.
We've had
Robert
him on.
Crane,
yes.
That's one of the most sterling thoughts I've ever heard of.
Yes. Probably one of the strangest interviews we ever had was the day we had both Pat Boone and Georgie Jessel together. It was one of those things. It was actually a goof up in our calendar, and they both ended up here. And here we've got Georgie Jessel, who originated everything that could possibly be thought of in life. And Pat Boone, who doesn't drink, doesn't smoke, he doesn't, he uses no profanity. And in fact, I was asking him how come his movie company, known as Cougamuga, where did he get the name? And Pat said it's because when he gets mad lots of times because he doesn't use profanity.
And I found myself,
yeah,
just not meaning to, but I found myself saying Great Cougamuga now and then, you know, because I don't swear and I sometimes have to say something.
You don't kiss or anything, do you?
No, I don't kiss, swear, drink. I just wear white shoes and have children.
What do you think of that, George? What do you think of that? I mean,
well, I think that, are you going, I know what to think of it, but I'm not going to say it.
He's a liar?
No, no. He probably has, I don't think that Pat has many vices.
No,
in fact, if they do, I'm sure his virtues outnumber them. And,
oh, really? That's rational.
I mean, I think that's a...
That's almost a vice in
it's
itself.
It's a nice sound, Cucamonga, and I must make a note not to hear that again. By the way...
What?
I see through this window here
yeah.
some of the loveliest looking girls. I had no idea.
No, George, no, George, no. You're here for an interview. You think you're coming in here to recruit. You're mistaken, frankly, and I knew you were going to ask that.
No, I tell you, I'm so intrigued.
Pull the microphone in, George.
So intrigued watching you, and I had never been to one of your shows. I listen to you religiously. In fact, that's one of the only religious things I do. And I'm fascinated by what you're doing. Just what it is you're doing, I don't know. But I've never seen so much accent in my life. Drum, and he's got all kinds of things over his ears and all sorts of concoctions. He looks like... I'm trying to think of what he looks like.
He looks like an astronaut. That's what he looks
either
like.
Either that or a Jew who's gone mad.
Oh, dear. Well, that'll give you an idea of what's been happening over the past 5 years with our interviews. Georgie Jessel and Pat. What did you think of that, Jack? Jack Chapman, by the way, is our Jim Dandy engineer. Been with us over 5 years now. What did you think, Jack?
Huh?
What did you think of the interview we just played, the portion of the interview?
Oh, I'm sorry. I wasn't listening.
Thanks a lot. You know the strangest thing? And in old-time radio, this could never be. Today, Jack Chapman is probably more widely known than I am. I can go out, make personal appearances. People don't know me. You know, they can't see me. You'd be surprised how many people can't see me. But anyway, Jack has a feeling that he is the important one. Even in playing records, he doesn't think the singers are important, the musicians, nothing.
Musicians mean nothing, the singers, the dancers.
Yeah, I know.
None of them mean nothing.
I know, Jim.
And it's true, because if you don't have a good engineer, you're never going to get to Cleveland. Now, I'm going to tell you about tape. Now, I tell you about tape. Now, you take a piece of tape like this, and you put one piece over here on one side of the mouth, one piece on this.
No, that's not the kind of tape, Jim.
What am I doing? That's the wrong kind
of
tape.
That's not the tape. Put the right tape on.
A tape machine, you don't use that kind of
tape. Right, you put the right tape on.
Like for bandages or something.
Yeah, put the right tape on. This is just to show you what a great engineer can be for a show. Go ahead.
Altogether different.
Yeah, altogether.
You put the tape on this side, and then you put it through a little thing over here, and then you twist it around over there, and you put another reel here, and then you turn on the machine, and here's what you hear on the tape.
Winston tastes good like a... cigarette should.
One of the all-time great engineers.
Up front in the tobacco end.
Always gets things absolutely perfect.
Winston gives you filter blend.
Thanks to the keen-sightedness of our engineer.
Up front in the tobacco end.
The flavor comes from filter blend.
All right, give us the message there, Charlie.
Yes, Steve, you're more than 9 years.
Oh, Amy, Jim. Jim. Oh, Jim, you got the tapes backwards. Jim.
How about that? That's backwards.
Well, put it.
Well, I'm going to fix that.
Will you
you see, when you hear a tape that's put on backwards like that, it sounds, you know, like it's real ridiculous.
Well, put the
but
thing
that
on
that. But isn't the way. It is,
right,
because then when
on
you
that.
Turn it around and you play it forward, we're going to re-thread it over here. I put it over here, play it forward for you,
and
now you are going to see what it really sounds like.
Winston tastes good like a cigarette should.
You should have left it the other way.
Filter Blend, Winston's own combination of golden, flavorful tobacco, specially selected, then specially processed, is why Winston tastes good like a cigarette should.
Winston tastes good like a cigarette should.
That's it. Winston does taste good like a cigarette should. And over KNX CBS Radio in Los Angeles, 1070 on your AM dial and 93.1 on your FM dial. This is Bob Crane on this Saturday afternoon with sort of a fifth anniversary show. Been here 5 years now doing the morning show Monday through Friday from 6 to 10, and on Saturday we're on from 8 until 12 noon. Jonathan Winters was our in-person guest around 6 months ago. And we did what Jonathan calls winging it, which means ad lib, a routine, where we only knew what we were going to do, but not where we were going to go with it. He was the Hollywood movie producer, and I was the young, aspiring actor trying to get a job, and this was the scene. Listen.
What is it, Bob? What kind of work, what do you want to do here? What are you doing here, by the way? Who's the agent? What's his name? What's his name, Bob? What's your agent's name? Quickly.
I'll be honest with you. I never met...
How'd he get through the gate?
I never met him before.
You never met him before?
Not my agent.
What, did he find you in the street or some discovery in over an ice cream cone?
It's a big...
What, are you talking about the old days, Bob? What do you want to do, Bob?
It's a big company, sir.
Sure, it's a big company. It's a billion-dollar company, kid. We got him going there. You're trying to tell me my business? Maybe you want to come behind the desk.
No, I don't
What
mean...
do you want, sweetheart? What is it, baby?
Want
to be up there beside Marlena? Is that it?
You get the
wanna
wrong...
Want to play Beau's Jest again for
no.
kids? We're putting Willard Foster in it. Crazy kid. He's 14 years old, but he memorizes in 2 seconds.
But my agent told me that I was very good.
Did he?
Yeah, he said.
What's good about you?
Well,
what have you done?
You really want to know?
What have you done? I really want to know. I'm not interested for 10 minutes.
Well, you talk so fast, I can't get...
Of course I talk fast. It's
Why?
A fast world. We got to wrap a series up in 26 minutes.
Oh,
sure. Burn a kid out and he's through by the time he's 30.
Well, the agent said to me, go in there and you're a very big man. And
That's right, I am.
You could help me.
And big physically and mentally.
Well,
I'm overweight and overtaxed, overtired, and I'm over the hill. It's that simple, kid. 75 pills a day, 16 syringes, and 5 bottles of juice. That's what keeps me going. 14 institutions in 5 years.
I've done little theater.
Little theater?
Yeah.
Stay with it. What you ought to do is stay in little theater the rest of your life. Get a little tiny place. Go off the beach. Get your friends to come in Levi's. You know, let their hair grow long. Play banjos the rest of your life.
No.
Oh, come on here. It'll drive you crazy, kid. It's
but
a big thing.
He told me I was right for the picture. He read
They're making a housing project out of the whole lot. It's over, kid, for me and you and everybody. It's all going to pay TV. I've got a job for you in radio as a jockey. How'd you like that?
Go away to Zuma
Beach and work out for a day.
No, you see, sir, I'm trying to get out of that. And I don't want to get out of it because it pays well, but I want to get into the acting thing. And I'd been, the agent told me that I'm right for the part. He read the script, and I thought you were producing a picture. That's why I'm here. You start hollering at me like you've been doing for the last 10 minutes. It's not my fault.
I'm sorry, kid. I suddenly looked at your face and saw myself. You're it, Bob Crane.
You mean I got the part?
You're our next leading man. You'll be bigger than Peck, bigger than Spencer Tracy, anybody out here.
Well, what made you change?
I love you.
That's it. Jonathan Winters and yours truly doing the movie producer and the aspiring actor. And by the way, I never did get the job. And I want to thank Jonathan for being or taking the part. You were taking a part there, Jonathan, right?
Yes, I was.
Come on. It's not your voice. Look at the time. It means we've used up everything we possibly can. We've played... what we felt were the best portions of our last 5 years here on the station.
I must say, when Bob Crane puts his mind to something, we are certainly winding up with thrills, aren't we?
Yes, and we would like to thank the over 300 people who have been our guests over the past 5 years for being with us, and everyone for listening today. And this is Bob Crane. I also want to thank our fine engineer, Jack Chapman, who spends so much time with us, of course.
My time is your time.
All right, Jack, come on, please.
I'm just a man.
Be some funny someday if I found out he was really Rudy Dally. This is Bob Crane saying until Monday morning, early in the morning. Goodbye, honey.
This is Pat Buttram. You know, I recently was an after-dinner speaker at a dinner at the Beverly Hilton Hotel honoring Senator Thomas Kuchel. It was $100 a plate dinner, and I had to take the roll and butter to my agent as his commission. But this Republican dinner was $100 a plate. And this week I'm speaking at a Democratic $50 a plate dinner. And then next month I'm going to a dinner where whoever furnishes the hot dogs, we'll vote for him. At this dinner, Mr. Jack Warner introduced me, and it was a wonderful audience.
Thank you, Mr. Warner. I think that... I'm just as proud as a peacock with two tails to be here tonight, and I am very honored to be here, especially with all the big names and the big distinguished people. In fact, I'm the only one on the dais that I never heard of. I represent the Tarzana group here. That's a little Ellis Island out in the valley where they keep you till you got enough money to move into Encino. But it's nice. With the freeway now, you can get into town in 20 minutes. I mean, whether you want to or not, you just... in fact, it's the only time I was ever in a traffic jam going 60 miles an hour. That's our freeway there. It's... the only thing, the cars go right, they jam right up against your rear bumper. You know, you ever notice that? They just right behind you, as if they're trying to determine the sex of your car or something. I don't know. It's terrible. And tonight coming here, there was a guy so close behind us that he pushed in his cigarette lighter and my wife went, ah! And another, tonight there was a guy whose tail light was out and I wanted to be helpful. So I stopped him, pulled him over and says, your tail light's out. And he got out and oh, he was mad. He was raring and using Harry Truman words all over the place. I said, nothing to worry about, it's just a tail light. He said, tail light hell, where's my trailer? So, I want to thank Mr. Warner for inviting me here. He's one of our fine, great after-dinner speakers. In fact, he'll talk for 2 hours if anybody opens a lunchbox somewhere. He started in the business as an entertainer, and you get an idea of why he gave that up. He's now in the production and the management end of it. In fact, it is said that Mr. Warner can take a star and overnight make them an unknown in this town. he's at Warner Brothers, you know, their slogan out there, combining good citizenship with shrewd bookkeeping. So, I mention all this because I was bringing up a point here, because I heard him talking to Senator Kuchel, and I just heard one sentence, and it worried me a bit. You know, he's a big television producer now, and all the series they have on. And I caught one sentence to Senator Kuchel. He says, we'll call the series Stagecoach Senator and we'll give you residuals on the first rerun. Of course, rerun, that's television talk. That's it means the evil that men do lives after them. But I wanted to sort of warn Senator Kuchel about going into television there. I mean, we can do better than that in town for you. We could get you on the Untouchables. There's a part they're looking for there. They need a tail gunner on a beer truck in one of the Also, Ralph Edwards is looking for someone now. He needs a standby relative on This Is Your Life. And then there's another big show they're doing. You might could get in it. It's a family show. It's a typical television show, a mixed marriage. The wife is schizophrenic and the husband is paranoid. And there's a conflict as how to raise the children. Or we can get you in a doctor series, Dr. Ben Kuchel, we make you do, where you operate while you're smoking a Marlboro, the sponsor's product, you know. And they operate on you with smoking. Use your navel as an ashtray, you know. If you're laying on your back, that is. You know. But it's a good thing you were under the anesthetic when they put out the butt. But I think that Senator, show business is not for you, and I think you should... No, it's tough. It's a real hectic life. For instance, you know, Zsa Zsa Gabor, she was... you read, you know, she was burned out completely. And then... she announced she's engaged to get married, so I don't know. Wasn't as burned out as we thought, I guess. It's a real tough business, Senator. Like, there's a good friend of ours, Sammy Davis, and he's having trouble. He has changed religion, and it's now when he goes down south, they won't let him on either end of the bus. You know? I think, don't listen to Mr. Warner. You stay in politics. We need you there. And it's easier, you know, like all you do is run for office and write books. Mr. Nixon's writing a book now, I understand, called Night Must Fall. But I don't want to get mixed up into that because a lot of people think that Mr. Nixon should be the governor. A lot of them think Mr. Knight should be. And there's a large group in town that think we should just let MCA handle it. I don't know. But the main thing, Senators, you stay there and stay healthy. You know, you have to take care of yourself because I remember in the mayor's race now, Mr. Polson, he had trouble with his voice. He kept saying things. Now, Mr. Yorty, he has trouble with his eyes. And his eyesight's been very bad. I mean, did you see a picture of that secretary he fired? Boy. If I may add my little thought here, we need you where you are in Washington and with the trouble we're having. I think, of course, the best way to get ahead of Russia is to get behind America. And I think it's men like you that will do that. And, of course, I'm not worried about, there's a big war scare, but I'm not worried about war until I see Norman Vincent Peale building a fallout shelter. So thank you for inviting me here, and will you validate my parking ticket?
Thank you, Pap, and I know all the ladies and gentlemen here tonight enjoyed you very, very much. And if they want to continue enjoying you, which I am one of your best customers while driving in the motor car, I want people to be quiet as in the car I turn him on. And he's very, very, very humorous. There's great psychology and philosophy and other 75-cent words that goes with it. You can hear him daily on KNX in the city here and on radio. And what is it, 1:30 to 2:30?
2:30.
He doesn't know when he's on. This is not the guy.
12:30
to 2:30. Oh, 12:30 to 2:30. It takes him 2 or 3 hours to sell that butter. But however, he's very humorous and a fine gentleman. I know we all appreciate you coming. And we thank you, and I hope to see you again at the same prices.
Well, that's enough of that. Anyway, another big dinner I was privileged to toastmaster was at a famous actors' club here in Hollywood. And even though the tape pickup is a little bad, I wanted to give you my introduction to one of the distinguished speakers on the dais, a struggling young comedian that I brought on this-a-way.
We are very honored. Our next guest, shooting his TV show today and came here and has another engagement to go to later. We're going to call on him now. He has a kind of a reputation of being a little tight with the money, but he's been great to us maskers. I know Joe Frisco used to say Benny is always good for a 5 or a 10, and even a quarter sometimes. And of course, there's a lot of kidding goes on about a picture he made. This horn blows at midnight, but it's great. We, some of us here, we see it 2 or 3 times a week. You know, it's part of the cure over at Alcoholics Anonymous. I think for the great good that he has done us there alone deserves a great welcome from Mr. Jack Benny.
Brother Maskers, fellow monologist. You know, I have been, in all modesty, I have been given credit for many years for having good timing, you see. But Pat Buttram makes me sound like Jack Warner.